That is a delight to have you with us.
Thank you. Thank you. Pulling up extra chairs. That's great. Well, I'm glad a topic like memory and mindfulness is getting a lot of people to be here. As Rich was saying, a lot of my work has really been about helping people to work with what they have right now rather than be upset or angry that they're not exactly who they used to be. That we all change and that we all have different strengths and vulnerabilities at different stages of our lives. And how do we work with some of the challenges that we have? And we're going to learn some different terms and topics. And then probably about 45 minutes, and then we'll open it up for discussion. So if you have questions, comments, concerns, you can raise your hand during, but or you can wait till after. It might be a little bit better. And as I said, as Rich was saying, I do have handouts. So a lot of some of the maybe poetry or some of the different ideas and philosophies, there are some books that I took it from, as well as from my own clinical experience. So let's just start out with some idea of what do we mean when we talk about this concept of mindfulness. So mindfulness is really the careful attention that we give to our moment-to-moment experience. And there are four elements of mindfulness that I want to just talk about so we can all be sort of on the same page here. But the first thing is attention. So mindfulness involves paying attention. Mindfulness involves paying attention to with intention. What's your motive? You know, a lot of times you may go to a yoga class or a meditation class and the teacher may say, you know, set an intention. Or you're going to some event and you tell yourself, I really want to be present, or I want to be kind, or I want to meet this person. So you're setting an intention then, sort of saying what you want from that experience. And then the third piece is really the idea of being present. Right, that a lot of times we may be either thinking about the past or thinking about the future, and what happens to the present moment when we do that? We lose it, right? So the idea is, how do we pay attention with intention in the present moment? And probably the most important piece of mindfulness is the idea of what's our attitude? Can we bring a kind-hearted attitude to whatever we're paying attention to? So a lot of times when we read things from Jon Kabat-Zinn or Jack Kornfield, these are people who teach a lot about mindfulness and meditation, the idea is, can we bring some self-compassion to our moment-to-moment experiences? Can we have a light-hearted approach to some of the challenges that we have as we're growing and growing older? So mindfulness really starts with noticing that you're breathing, right? One of the things we can't leave home without is our breath, our inhale and our exhale. And a lot of times, you know, if you're stressed out about something, someone may say to you, you know, just take a few deep breaths. And one of the reasons we're doing that is, first of all, we're just trying to pause, right? We're hoping not to react to our first thought. That sometimes it's better to take a moment to pause and think about, you know, maybe there's a different way to approach the situation than maybe an impulsive way we may have in the past. And the idea, too, that if we are taking an inhale and then having a nice long exhale, we're actually physiologically, we are activating our parasympathetic nervous system. This is part of the autonomic nervous system that says, rest and digest. Everything is okay. You know, no need to run from the tigers or the scary monsters. So the idea of inhaling and exhaling, which we do a lot in meditation, noticing that keeps us more present and focused in the moment. So if you're sitting there and you're inhale, exhale, inhale, one, two, three, exhale, one, two, three, four, you're less likely to be able to worry about what you need to do next, what you said before, all these kinds of ideas that get us a little bit stressed out, or maybe the mind chatter that really makes it so hard to think about anything else. Mindfulness is not. So it's always good to know what works and what doesn't work, but mindfulness is not ruminating on the past. You know, like the cow who eats the grass and spits it out and eats the same grass and spits it out. So the idea is we don't want to continue to ruminate. Oh, I should have done it this way, I should have done it that way. That really puts us in a place where we are not in the present moment. You know, we may be emotionally beating ourselves up. And really, the message here is how can we practice self-kindness? How can we practice being gentle with ourselves? Anticipating the worst-case scenario. And that is not mindfulness. Mindfulness is more just really being with what is. And some things aren't so great. And some things are neutral. And some things are really good. But the idea not to, you know, make this kind of huge, huge mountain when it really is just something smaller like a molehill. And mindfulness is not getting distracted by all the waves of thoughts and everything that go through our mind all the time. And the truth is, the mind wanders. That's what it does. But can we learn how to bring it back to the present moment? Can we take an inhale and an exhale and just be here now? And the idea of the automatic pilot mode is you leave your apartment. You know, did I bring my keys with me? Did I shut off the coffee pot? Did I turn off the TV? Well, that's sort of the mindless way, right? We're kind of on automatic pilot mode. But can we pause and have our mental checklist? You know, Atul Gawande, who wrote the book Being Mortal, before that he wrote the book Checklist Manifesto. And that's the idea of, can we have a checklist? Okay, do I have my keys? Do I have my glasses? Do I have my cell phone? Did I turn this off? You know, so that we really are paying attention. Let's just look at, so we're talking about mindfulness, we're talking about memory. And so memory, really just a simple definition is that memory is just learning new information or recalling past information. So relying on our memory, whereas in the past or in different stages of our lives, maybe we didn't need to write things down. Maybe we didn't need to refer to a calendar or to our little journal, whatever it might be. But as we get older, and we'll talk about how the brain ages like every other part of our bodies do, that we really need to be effortful in our memory consolidation. That if we want to remember something, we really need to pay attention with intention in the present moment with a kind-hearted attitude towards self. So consolidation of short-term memory into long-term memory really requires our wholehearted attention. Unlike these two women who are sitting around talking, and one says to the other, my memory is so bad, and she says, how bad is it? And the other one says, how bad is what? You know, how quickly we're just off onto something else. We're not really paying attention. Like with anything else, how do we set ourselves up for success? Right? Well, we avoid distractions. If you say, you know, there's a book I want to read, and it's just sitting there on the shelf, and you haven't picked it up because there's so many other things that seem so much more important, then that's really hard to say. If that's what you say you wanted to do is read this book, then you really have to make time for it. You need to avoid distractions. Maybe you need to go somewhere quiet. Maybe you need to turn off the ringer on your phone, whatever it is. Your new mantra, right, is not let's multitask and do five things at once and so we get all these different things done in a mediocre way. But really, the brain does not like to multitask. It does not want its attention divided. Maybe at earlier stages of our lives, you know, we needed to juggle a bunch of things, but in the second half of our life, there's more opportunity with the less constraints of certain things, jobs, family, whatever it may be, that really we can learn how to focus and finish. Focus on this project, finish it before you go to the next one. Otherwise, there's that kind of free-floating, oh gosh, I need to do this, I need to do that. And say no to worrying and hurrying. I want to get everybody a t-shirt that says in bold letters, slow down. Right? Because as we get older, that's what naturally happens anyway. Right? We slow down. It takes longer to do things. It takes longer to get ready to go somewhere. It takes longer sometimes to understand how to figure out how to use my new whatever technology you have. You know, sometimes even in conversation, it takes longer to process information. That doesn't mean something terrible is happening. It just means your brain is aging like every other part of our body's age. And again, how do we set ourselves up for success? We pay attention in a very particular way. We make an effort. If you're going to some family event or some event with friends and you want to be able to talk about it after with somebody, be there for it. Don't be somewhere else. Be right there for it. When I worked at Yale, I was doing testing with even some of the professors there. And one gentleman was like, oh my gosh, I really think I'm getting Alzheimer's disease. I can't remember anything. We did all the testing. And you know, the good news was it wasn't Alzheimer's. What it was he had high anxiety. And he was so busy juggling so many things that he'd be in a meeting and he'd leave the meeting and say, I have no idea what happened. And so we started practicing mindfulness. And we started practicing this easy sort of phrase of when you started to notice, right? And that's what I'm saying about mindfulness. Notice what you notice. Notice, be aware of what thoughts are going through your head. When you notice that your mind is wandering off and you don't want it to, just tell yourself, stay here. And he started working on that in meetings, just telling himself, stay here. Because I know, predicting our obstacles, that's one of my obstacles, that I tend to have a mind that wanders when I don't want it to. So to bring yourself back to stay here. Or nobody has to see that you're taking an inhale and an exhale, and you're just kind of concentrating and pausing there. But that might be what you need to do to enhance your ability to remember things that you want to remember. So what is the rush? Gary Small is a psychiatrist at UCLA in the memory and aging department there. He's written several books. The Memory Bible is one where he says, when we have little interest in something, it's often difficult to remember because we're not paying full attention. It's essential to slow down just enough to notice if what is being said is something that's important enough to remember. So that's the thing, because forgetting is an adaptive process, right? It's not necessary to remember everything. We'd be completely on overload if we did that. So what do I want to remember? You know, I'm going to this bar mitzvah, I'm going to this wedding, whatever it may be, and you want to remember it. So you need to be there, be present, and then you talk about it after. There's a neuropsychologist, and he's on the list too, Rick Hansen. He's written several books. One's called Buddha's Brain, and one is called Hardwiring Happiness. But he talks about this idea of taking in the good. Taking in the good moments, because of course they're going to be not so good moments too. But can we take in the good moments, remember them, and then we share them with somebody else? You know, I went to see this movie and it was so wonderful. It was really about the concept that life is messy, but it's okay. Or, you know, I had such a great time with my niece and we did this and that. And you share that, because even as you're saying that, even as you're taking in those good moments that you took in the moment you were there, later when you share it with other people, that's also a way that we color our experiences, right? So if I'm thinking about all the downers, then that's kind of what my flashlight sees. But if I'm thinking more about taking in the good moments, I can also, they're going to be consolidated easier so that I can remember them later. So that's your choice, in a sense. So what do we mean by cognitive functioning? We hear this phrase, cognitive functioning. You know, my cognitive functioning is good, bad, in between, or whatever is changing. But it's really an intellectual process, and it's the idea of thinking, perceiving, learning new information, recalling past information, building relationships. We need our cognitive functioning really ultimately to live and to love in this world. So cognitive functioning really relies on the working of our amazing brain. And we've got two terms here. So neurogenesis is really just the growing of new neurons. Neurons are brain cells. I'll show you a couple of pictures of them. But about 20 years ago or something, we didn't know that neurons, that brain cells could regenerate, that we could grow new ones. The thought was, you grow up, you grow old, brain shrinks, end of story. Well, thank goodness that's not the whole story. The story is that we can actually grow branches on our neurons and their dendrites. I'll show you pictures of those. That through different kinds of lifestyle interventions, we can actually keep our brains robust. And another part, and we also know that you can grow new neurons in the hippocampus. Now, this is the part of our brain, it's in the temporal lobes, and what in the temporal lobe, and what it does is it consolidates short-term memory to long-term memory. There are now a lot of neuroradiologists who, when somebody's going, let's say, to one of the brain centers and they're having a full testing done, that when they have an MRI done of the brain, what they're being, the person who's looking at it is trained in neuroradiology, and what they can actually see is the volume of the hippocampus. That a person who the information decays really quickly, you know, you read them 10 unrelated words over 4 trials, and then 20 minutes later you ask them to remember some of those words and they say, "What list?" Right? That is very different than the person that gives you a few words and then you say to them, "Well, I'm going to say a few words and you tell me, was it on the list or not?" So can this person recognize some words? Do they just need some cueing? Right? So there are different ways that we can tell what's happening in the brain. But one of the ways that we can tell if information is decaying quickly is to do these neuropsychological tests. But also, it's then backed up by looking at brain imaging, which can show the volume of the hippocampus has gotten smaller. And a lot of times, if that's the case, then we're thinking this is probably, possibly, a neurodegenerative disease process like Alzheimer's happening. Neuroplasticity. The brain changes with different experiences. When I was at Laguna Honda, it was amazing to see people coming in after having a stroke, or some major head trauma, all bandaged up, not able to speak or understand things, not able to walk or move around well. And then after having occupational therapy, physical therapy, speech therapy, cognitive therapy, that we would see that other parts of the brain where there may have been the damage, other parts can take over. And if you have had a stroke or someone you know has had a stroke, you can see that over the first 2 years is when it's really important to do these kinds of therapies. Because what we do see is that other parts of the brain can take over. And that's the amazing part, and that's why neuroplasticity is something so hopeful for all of us. Oliver Wendell Holmes said, "Man's mind, once stretched by a new idea, never regains its original dimension." Now, he probably wasn't thinking neuroplasticity, but this is the idea here, right? That the brain does change with different experiences. So here's a neuron. So you kind of see that with the dendrites there, those, you know, they're sort of like the fingers on your hand. Those branches are what take in information and send out information. And that we now know that those dendrites can sprout new connections and new spines on them. We want to have that. We want to have more robust brain because as we age, we know that the brain does get smaller. So what we do to kind of combat that natural aging process is some of these lifestyle interventions that we're going to talk about. Just another picture so you see it. You've got the cell body, and then you've got the axon, and then over there are the dendrites that can continue to sprout. Cognitive aging at UCSF are doing a lot of work on kind of coining this term, which I think is really important because it kind of normalizes the fact that the brain ages. Right? The idea here is that cognitive aging, it happens to all of us. It happens to every single one of us. And it implies how the brain changes in its physical structure and how the brain changes in its ability to carry out different kinds of functions, like remembering, like organizing, sequencing, following through on a task. All of that changes. We call that the executive functioning skills. Our ability to plan, to organize, to sequence, to follow through on things. You know, let's say you were making dinner for some friends. Your executive functioning skills come into play there. What do I have in the house? What do I need to go shopping for? What am I cooking? Who am I inviting? All those kinds of questions and planning and sequencing. Got to make sure the rice is done in time with the salmon and all of that. That's our executive functioning skills. Those can continue to be sharpened and toned just like we tone our bodies when we're doing physical activity. So the brain ages and changes. So some of the consequences of cognitive aging that we see in our daily life may be, for example, difficulty remembering names. Okay, this doesn't mean that you're headed for the skilled nursing facility and you're going to end up, you know, just not knowing anything at all. I mean, that's not what this means, right? This is just, it's difficult to remember names because by the time we get to be the age we are, we have a lot of information in the brain. And there's a lot of things that we're already storing. And one of the things we notice most of all when I teach my use it or lose it workshops is that's what happens, is people raise their hand and say, well, the reason I came to this program was because I just can't remember names. And, you know, there's nothing wrong with saying, you know, remind me of your name. Because they probably don't remember your name either. And when you live in a community like this, I mean, it's very overwhelming and can be intimidating initially, and for a while, even in the dining room or whatever. So there are ways that, you know, it's not like you should just isolate yourself because you can't remember names. It shouldn't be something that we think makes us embarrassed about it, because a lot of people have problems with names as we get older. Where did I put my whatever? Right? You have your sacred little dish. You keep your keys, you keep your glasses, when you put them there. Right? I mean, strategies. At any stage of our lives, we need strategies. But especially for memory consolidation, we need to not be, you know, spending a lot of time getting frustrated and beating ourselves up emotionally because we can't find our glasses. You know, what are you going to do so that you can remember? Whether you have them around your neck or you have them in a certain area that you keep them, have a strategy. Now, why did I come in this room? That ever happened? Why did I come in this room? Okay, well, if you're in one room and you're realizing, oh no, I need my scissors. So as you're walking from one room to the next, and hopefully your place isn't too big, so you're staying this for too long, but I need my scissors, 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 scissors. By the time I get into the kitchen, I know why I came into the kitchen, right? I wanted my scissors. Okay, that works. Again, we talked about multitasking. Focus and finish. Enough of trying to get so many different things done, you're just going to be frustrated. You know, can we name that that's a challenge and then put something in place so we don't keep trying to do it over and over again expecting it to be different? Because it's not. We've got to do something differently. And we're finding difficulties, right? That one is, that the brain, that's us showing that our brain is aging. You know, this happens in our 40s and 50s. But we don't get scared or upset about it until later because it happens a little bit more frequently, and now we're thinking it means something else because we're future tripping rather than staying in the moment and just saying, okay, the word will come to me eventually. But I can promise you that all of us have that problem with finding the right word when we need it. And a lot of times, sometimes if some people have it more than others, that issue, sometimes you just say to your friends, sometimes I have a problem with coming up with a word. You feel free to just offer some words you think might be the ones. Right? Instead of having them sit there struggling for 20 minutes. So word finding difficulties, this is a cute poem, this is called Vocabulary Downsizing. It must be getting crowded on the tip of my tongue with all those languid words, laid off, lethargic, lounging around in their underwear in despair of ever being called up again, right? You know, it's but she wrote this poem. This is from people for over 50, because it happens. So mindful effort and lifestyle really does matter. Practice, practice, practice. Physically, keep moving. Be active. Emotionally, let go of thoughts that don't serve you well. Are you talking to yourself like you would talk to a dear friend, or are you beating yourself up? Right? Socially, that's why I love communities like the Sequoias. You have your privacy and your place when you want it, and when you want to be with other people, you're just an elevator ride away. Socializing, right? The opposite of that really isn't so helpful to become isolated. Isolation can lead to depressive feelings, and that's not good for our cognitive functioning. Nutritionally, follow a Mediterranean-like diet. Sleep hygiene. Sleep is a restorative process. And we're going to talk, I'm just going through these quickly because we'll have a little bit more in depth about them. Intellectually, be curious, right? Stay interested. John Gardner at Stanford had this wonderful talk called The Road to Self-Renewal, and he said, everybody wants to be interesting, but the important thing is to be interested, to stay curious, right? Have a questioning mind. Be aware, be awake. Thoreau said, only that day dawns to which we are awake. Are we sleepwalking through our lives, or are we awake for what we want to be awake for? So then there's the guy, he's with St. Peter at the pearly gates, and he says, since you have a complete record of my life, could you tell me if I remember to turn the stove off? Wake up, right? So the use it or lose it theory, okay, we're going to get really technical here, but really it's just saying that the brain gets rusty if we don't use it. The brain cells get the message you're not that important, and then they start drooping, right? So the idea is that we really need to know that the brain does prune as we get older. And so if we are using our brain more, we are making more connections in the brain, right? The more you do something, the stronger and more efficient the connection between the brain cells becomes. Albert Einstein said, learn from yesterday, live for today, hope for tomorrow. The important thing is never stop questioning the curious mind. Am I engaging in physical activity? Whatever that means to you, given your own resources, right? Am I connecting with others? Am I socializing? Am I making healthy food choices most of the time? I put sort of most of the time in, because, you know, we don't know what's going on. Am I getting enough sleep? Am I sleeping too much? Am I aware of my stressors and how to reduce my stressors? Am I creating harmony or harm with my thoughts? Like, a lot of times we don't even notice what we're telling ourselves, and we'll talk a little bit more about that. What we practice in our lives becomes stronger in our lives. Whatever we regularly think about, it really does color our experience. I mean, do you wake up in the morning and say, thank you, universe, I have another day, I'm breathing, I'm awake, I'm alive, I have an opportunity to be kind to myself, to be compassionate toward other people? Or do I wake up and go, oh, beep, another day? You know, I mean, that's going to color how your day goes, right? Usually we're only half conscious of the way our thoughts direct our lives. You know, what are the messages that you're telling yourself? In my work with folks who struggle with anxiety, which can be manifesting in rumination, dwelling on certain things, restlessness, worrying, thinking about the worst case scenario of everything, one of the things that I try to help them see is how much their thoughts and the messages that they tell themselves are impacting how they feel and what they do or what they don't do. Because there is a connection. And I can't tell somebody else what to think, but somebody else in their own body and mind needs to be able to notice, you know what, I'm not on my own team here. I am not practicing kindness toward myself. I would never say this to my friend if she came to me and she was struggling or suffering. Why am I saying it to myself? I mean, can we be our own friend? What a concept. But that's the idea, is that a lot of times we put these obstacles in our own way, and I promise you, they will impact the quality of your memory and the quality of your ability to be present for those people in your life who you say are important to you. Are we directing our attention on what we have or on what we've lost? You know, yes, we all have limitations, and at every stage of our lives we have limitations and we have strengths. And I think that you'll notice that if you're shining the flashlight on the things you have more often than on the things that you don't have, and less time on comparing yourself to other people, I think you're going to feel better. And you know, we take our own mind chatter so seriously, as if what we think is the truth. Like, you know, people make the joke, don't believe everything you hear on the internet. Well, the truth is sometimes we think our thoughts are real. You know, people, oh gosh, it's horrible, right? It's just terrible. And the truth is, okay, some things are, but let's get more specific. Because if you have that blanket sweeping statement, I mean, that doesn't give you much hope to be feeling better or to feeling more of an opportunity to notice when you're being mean to yourself or saying things that aren't serving your best interests or the people in your life. So here's the squirrel, and he's at the psychiatrist's office on the couch, and he said, gosh, when I thought about it, you are what you eat. I started to believe I was nuts. Okay, beliefs about aging, they do matter. So Satchel Paige in the Baseball Hall of Fame, 1906-83, said, age isn't a problem. It's a question of mind over matter. If you don't mind, it doesn't matter. I was with someone today, and she said, you know, you really have to own your aging. I said, what do you mean? I thought I knew what she meant, but I just wanted to get a better sense because she seemed so wise. And she said, well, you really have to celebrate your strengths. And I said, that's funny, because I'm going to talk about that today. Because that's one of the things that I want us all to try to do more of, is to really celebrate our strengths. And we'll name a few of them. So the attitude adjustment. So everyone reacts differently to stressful events. But there's new research to show that a positive outlook on aging really can buffer against the strong emotional impact of aging and daily stressors. So people who had negative views about aging were impacted more by stressful situations. I remember when I was just doing some work, I do this class called Brain Boot Camp at the Peninsula Region in San Mateo. And I mean, I'm meeting every 2 weeks with some of the women in my group are 100. I've got three of them that are 100 years old. And we were talking about this concept of optimism and health. And we were talking about how the research shows that people who are more optimistic usually enjoy more higher quality health. And we were talking about, so why? Why might that be? And we really came up with the same answer that all the researchers do, is that people who are more optimistic, who can most of the time see the glasses half full as opposed to half empty, are more likely to handle stress better. And because we all have stress and we have to figure out what it is for us that reduces that stress. Mark Twain said, my life has been filled with terrible misfortunes, most of which have never happened. Do we stress ourselves out like that? You know, I always get a chuckle from this because it's so true. You know, I mean, we're off in our minds when it's so horrible, and you know, most of those things are never going to happen. You know, I'm just waiting for when blah, blah, blah happens. Okay, well, you just lost this moment where blah, blah, blah is not happening. You know, oh, you know, vision support groups, when some people are saying, you know, it's pretty bad now, but I just know it's going to get so much worse. But the truth is, it's not worse right now. Maybe you think about that then. There's a social psychologist who says, okay, a lot an hour or two a week to worry. So Wednesdays 2 to 4 is when I worry, right? If it's not Wednesday 2 to 4, okay, that's not when I'm worrying, right? Kind of a cool idea. I don't know if you can all do it. So healthy cognitive aging involves identifying and saving our inner strengths. This is what this woman was talking about today, and this is what I completely agree that we don't do enough of. You know, are you a good listener? Are you a good friend? Do you have compassion for other people, for yourself? Are you resilient? Have you been through some really tough times, and I'm sure all of us in this room have? How did you bounce back? Here you are right now. You know, these are things that we can see really as our inner strengths. Practicing kindness for ourselves and for other people. Patience, right? That can be a tough one. You know, I want the caterpillar to turn into the butterfly right this minute. Well, it's not going to happen when you want it. It's going to happen, unfold in its own process. Practical intelligence, right? That's our ability to our street smarts, our emotional intelligence. These are all ways that we have inner strengths. Do I regulate my emotions, or do my emotions regulate me? It's kind of a good question to ask yourself. What about trying a little tenderness? If we look at some of the loving kindness meditations, some of the affirmations are starting out with, may I hold myself with care and respect. May I treasure my life. You know, may I be filled with kindness. May I practice compassion for myself and others. You know, may I be free from harm. May you be free from harm. May people I don't know be free from harm. You know, a lot of the idea, too, around sort of what we practice becomes stronger in our lives is this idea of what we think about really colors our experiences of the world. So there are many different factors that influence the quality of our cognitive functioning. There's stress, there's levels of physical activity, attention and effort to remember, how actively the mind is being used, resiliency and a sense of self purpose and meaning in our lives, sleep, nutrition, anxiety. I mean, there are quite a few. I mean, when I'm doing neuropsychological testing, I need a lot of background information first. I need a lot of test results because I need to see what some of the reversible reasons for this person's memory problems or executive functioning disturbance, and what can we treat. And what can we change with lifestyle interventions or omissions? So stress in the brain. Stress is a very personal process, right? What's stressful for me may be a walk in the park for somebody else. And really, the fact is that prolonged exposure to stress, it actually does shrink brain cells in the hippocampus, which is what we learned is sort of the memory center of the brain. That if you are stressed out for a long period of time, cortisol gets released from our adrenal glands, it goes right up to the brain, to the hippocampus, and it does kill brain cells. So this fact is really another good reason to figure out what stresses you out and how to reduce the stress. Because a lot of times, that's what we're seeing is why somebody is forgetful or having issues, because they are having a difficult time managing their stress. And there are ways that we can help with that, too. You can change some of the things. You know, sometimes people think, oh, a few drinks and I feel great. You know, but drinking can impact the quality of your sleep. It does impact our central nervous system. It's a depressant on it. Maybe taking a walk, calling a friend, listening to some music, going to a yoga class, going to be with some friends, maybe a better and more healthy way to reduce stress. So Robert Sapolsky, a biologist at Stanford, wrote this book called Why Zebras Don't Get Ulcers. You know why zebras don't get ulcers? Because they're not ruminating like we are. I should have done it this way. Oh, what if this happened? Right, right. And cortisol doesn't linger in their blood systems. So stress is generally episodic for animals that are running away from predators, while for us humans, stress is often chronic, worrying about losses or what's going to happen. And that's why wild animals, he's saying in his book, are less susceptible than humans to chronic stress-related disorders. All right, so here we are. The guy, he's at the doctor's office, and he says, I'm learning how to relax, doctor, but I want to learn how to relax better and faster, and I want to be on the cutting edge of relaxation. You know, that's not how you do it. That's not how you do it. Social and intellectual stimulation, that also enhances the brain. Okay, so we know we're thinking about novelty, variety, and frequency. So if you're going to say, oh, are crossword puzzles enough? Well, my doctor says if you do crossword puzzles, you just get to be good at crossword puzzles. Well, maybe that's true, but there's another part of it. You're being mindful. You're paying attention with intention in that present moment. You are not thinking about all the other stressors in your life, so you're giving your brain a break from that. And then I always suggest, okay, so come up with a word from the crossword puzzle that you don't know, and then challenge yourself. I'm going to look it up, I'm going to write down the meaning, and I'm going to try to use it in conversation. You know, I'll impress those people in the dining room, you know. But the idea, too, is that we need other people. You know, one of the social psychologists was saying, you know, do you ever see any happy hermits? But the truth is we do need other people, and that we get a lot of validation from our interactions with other people. So we want to try different kinds of activities, lectures, book clubs, right? You read a book and that's great, or you see a movie, that's great, but go a step further and talk about it with somebody. Because I know how I felt about the movie, but I'd be interested to hear what your perspective is. Because that's sprouting more dendrites in my brain. Like, oh, you know what? I never thought of it that way. You know, it opens things up more. You know, take that step further sometimes. So, love Marion Diamond. She's at UC Berkeley. She's done a lot of work with brain health and does a lot of work with rats. And she says, one way to be certain of continued enrichment is to maintain curiosity throughout lifetime, always asking questions of yourself or others, and in turn, seeking out the answers provides continual challenge to nerve cells. She did a lot of tests where there was like maybe a couple of rats in one cage with just food and water, and then another cage had lots more rats, and there were some toys in there, and the twirly things, and they were doing all sorts of activities. And the ones that were also in the more socialized environment, they also were held. So they were held for longer. And the other ones weren't. They were just food, water, the basics. And when they did the autopsies on the brains, they did find that the brains of those who were more socialized and were held, not only did they live longer, but they also, their brains were more robust. So I think we can translate that to human experience. So what qualifies as socially and intellectually stimulating activities? You have them here at the Sequoias. There's dancing, there's discussion groups, attending activities, acting in plays, reading, word games, writing, a bunch of them, learning languages, singing, knitting, crocheting, trying something new. You know, even if you walk one way to the store, try walking a different way. Get a different set of stimulation when you do that. I think this is really important too, because there's a lot of research now about meaning and purpose and how it boosts our cognitive functioning. That our brain is really strengthened by our belief that we have purpose and meaning in our lives. You know, what does matter to you? Are you pursuing things that you say are important to you? You know, that is part of what we call kind of this building up of our cognitive reserve. That let's say there's this savings account of neurons that we deposit by every time we do something socially stimulating, every time we eat right, every time we do some sort of physical activity, we are building up our cognitive reserve. We're studying more, we have challenging careers, or we start volunteering, or whatever it may be. That we're building up this reserve of neurons so that as the natural aging process happens, we can actually withdraw from that bank account of neurons so that we can actually work with the challenges of getting older. Cognitive functioning is also enhanced by our our ability to have some kind of purpose and meaning in our lives. And it's very different, right? Viktor Frankl, who wrote Man's Search for Meaning, he says that meaning and purpose, it's a dynamic process, that it changes at different stages of our lives. And maybe now, for some of you, it may be, I just want to be gentle and kind to myself. My whole life I've been rushing, running around, and I just want to pause. I just want to be kind to myself, because I know if I can do that, that also kind of sets the pebble in the pond getting bigger and bigger for my ability to be kind to other people. You know, it doesn't always have to be productivity means going out and making money or whatever it might be. But productivity in the second half of our lives is going to look very different. Maybe we want to have a deeper relationship with family and friends. Maybe we want to read more. Whatever it may be. But that idea of what's my meaning and purpose in life is something to think about. And do we ever take a few moments just to think about that? So Mary Oliver is a poet, and she's written lots of poetry, but this one, Instructions for Living a Life. Pay attention, be astonished, and tell about it. Pay attention, be astonished, and tell about it. You know, so really we get that idea of the wonder. We get the idea of really concentrating on something and being with it. And then we share it with other people. Taking in the good, as Rick Hansen says, right? It was such a great holiday this year because I blah, blah, blah. And then when you're feeling down in the dumpsters, remember that, how great it felt. You know, that would kind of help you out of it. So here we go. Here's how to enhance brain health. Celebrate your inner strengths. Maybe make a list of what they are. Engage in new learning. Be thankful, be curious, be interested. Maintain a healthy diet. Build positive social connections. Learn and listen and play. Practice mindfulness and being compassionate towards self, right? It's very easy for us to see somebody else's suffering and hope that it would be less. But what about our own suffering? Can we notice when we're feeling down? Can we notice when we're suffering and want our own suffering to be less? You know, that is part of the whole process of being gentle towards ourselves. And I promise you that will help you with your cognitive functioning. Because ultimately, cognitive functioning, as we said, it's an intellectual process where we're thinking, we're perceiving, we're remembering, we're learning new information, and it's really about building relationships and living and ultimately loving. And we want to find effective ways to lower stress, whatever that looks like for you. And think about it. And you know, sometimes I was working with someone the other day, and he just said, well, I'm just going to write some of these things down because when I'm stressed out, I can't even think. So maybe if I write it down, okay, I walk down to the cafe, there are a couple of people that I spend some time with there. I love to go to the library. I actually like to make like fried eggs, okay? Whatever it is, you know, so that you have it there for you. And you want to exercise all of you, body, brain, and spirit. And finally, to sculpt your finest brain. Okay, so reduce stress. Make time for pleasurable activities. Learn relaxation techniques such as meditation. I'm sure there are some classes that you can go to here. Avoid overscheduling. Stimulate your brain. Avoid routine. Get a little bit out of your comfort zone sometimes. Exercise. You know, a brisk walk. Whatever it is that you're capable of doing, do it. And then cross-train, too. So that, you know, you don't just go to the gym and say, okay, one, two, three, I'm done. Maybe you do upper body one day, you do lower body another day, you take walks, maybe you do some stretch and tone, maybe you do some resistance training, whatever it may be. Challenge your mind. You know, try different kinds of puzzles or Sudoku or taking a class. Try something different and really kind of learn to do it and then help somebody else to learn how to do that too. And stay healthy. You know, you want to eat a nutritious diet and you want to get adequate sleep, right? Sleep, we're saying, it's a restorative process. A lot of consolidation happens when we're sleeping. So if you're not getting a good night's sleep, maybe you could talk to your doctor. Maybe there's some things you need to do differently. And that's really helpful, because if you feel well rested when you wake up in the morning, you're more likely to be able to deal with stress, you're more likely to make decisions, you feel better. It's really important. And then also, we want to really water the seeds of socialization, of connection, and of compassion for ourselves and others. So that's it in a nutshell. A lot of information.